Well, thank you. I'd like to welcome everyone here in the offices of WilmerHale, and also viewing us through the web. You're all very welcome. This event is a discussion, but it's also a celebration of the launching of a book. I gather Gary Bourne has produced a small monograph that has grown over time into this multi-volume set. I think we're joined by Gwyn DeVries tonight. Gwyn, are you here? Gwyn's in the back, and Gwyn represents the publisher here. So this event is brought to you both by WilmerHale and the publisher, Wolters Kluwer. So pleasure to have you here, Gwyn. So our plan tonight is to do a wonderful thing, that we launch a book with a discussion of an issue, not with a discussion of the book, which has its own incestuous feeling to it, but rather doing what we enjoy, which is to think about a case, think about a particular issue. My name is David Caron. I have the privilege to serve as Dean of King's College London, Law. And we will have a panel of Dr. Maxi Scherer. I'm going to invite them up in a moment, of WilmerHale. Johnny Veeder is with us from Essex Court Chambers, and they will both comment on the case briefly, and then in a moment of a sage outburst of wisdom, we'll have a comment from Gary himself, and then some discussion among the three of them, and then turning to you here and on the web for questions. So let me turn to, I just want to lay out the facts very quickly. And so thank you, Oliver, for... Okay. So let me lay out the facts for you for a second, just so you have the case in perspective and where we're at. So let's just put a timeline out very quickly. And what we're going to do is focus, and it's off the screen, but on the left there, you see a little NA. So there's a way to do this. Hold on. A little too far. But you can see it says Argentina over there on the left. And we can go back in. And so in 1991, late 1990, there's a BIT between the United Kingdom and Argentina. And then in 92, Metrogas is created. And the group, the plaintiff in the case we have, the petitioner, is BG Group. And BG Group is the consortium that had the winning bid in this. We then go all the way out to the year 2000, when we have the Argentine economic crisis. And as you know, over that coming year, we have the devaluation of the peso. There's a particular act in 2002 where the president of Argentina is issuing a decree that's affecting the availability of courts. So that's everything that happens you need to know about Argentina for the moment. Now, if we go back out, there's our timeline again for Argentina. If we go below the timeline, what you see on the left there are two things on the bottom. One is now uncentral arbitration, but in Washington, D.C. So the seat is in Washington. We're going to be within the U.S. legal system for that arbitration. And then in red, we're going to have what happens in U.S. courts after the arbitration. So if we go back out to 2002, you can see the president of Argentina is now acting on the courts, the economic crisis is going, and BG initiates that uncentral arbitration seated in Washington, D.C. So we're putting it below the line in this maroon color. 2004 to 2006, these arbitration proceedings take place. Late in 2007, we have the final award, and Maxi will explain everything that's happening here, but a prime issue is jurisdiction. And in the 2004 to 2006, there's an argument as to whether conditions about jurisdiction had been fulfilled within Argentina. But the tribunal here in December 2007 has found jurisdiction, ruled in favor of BG Group on the merits, and awarded $185 million. We now go to the red. We then go into United States court. to seek confirmation and to seek vacation or seek annulment, just a synonym for that word. And Argentina is seeking vacation for lacking jurisdiction in this case. The district court, sometime later, denies Argentina's claims. The Court of Appeals more quickly reverses that decision. So in other words, has vacated the award. This is the first U.S. court action involving a treaty, investor treaty arbitration, right? Not through ICSID, but under UNCITRAL. And then most recently, in March of this year, the Supreme Court reverses the Court of Appeals, thereby reinstating the district court and confirming the award. And that's basically the layout of this case and the timeline you can sort of envision. Now, I'm going to invite our panelists up. Maxi, I gather, has slides also, so maybe the rest of the panel should wait a moment while she can go through hers, and you can go from here. And so it's my pleasure to welcome to the podium Maxi Scherer from the firm WilmerHale.
More rudimentary. They're just PowerPoint. I don't have this, you know, cheeky Mac slides. So thank you very much, David, for your kind introduction remarks and for the excellent layout of the facts. Let me add my welcome to all of you here in Park Lane and our offices, but also the many others who are registered online at the live stream. I'm very, very pleased to discuss this very interesting case, BG, with you tonight. What I will do is I will go through the BG case, but with a particular focus. I will focus on the BG case from someone who is a not US lawyer, and in particular a civil lawyer. So I will look at it with that particular focus as a non-US lawyer and civil lawyer, and that will require me from time to time to put some footnotes, warnings, and explanations that maybe aren't necessary for the US lawyers amongst you. What I'm going to do is I'm going to look at the various issues and questions that the Supreme Court looked at and decided upon. Then I'm going to give you a little bit of background and context by looking at the previous case law in the US, and I hope that is helpful for the non-US lawyers amongst us in the room. And then I will actually analyze the BG decision, both the majority and the dissent, because there was a dissent. So this is our menu for tonight. Turning at the issues at stake, as David had already explained, the real core question was the interpretation of Article 8 of the bilateral investment treaty between UK and Argentina. And basically what it does, this provision, is that in paragraph 1, it says that the parties should bring disputes to the local courts. That's the courts of the contracting parties in whose territory the investment was made. And then it goes on in paragraph 2 to provide for international arbitration in certain circumstances. One of those circumstances is paragraph 2A little 1, and that is the contentious provision. It provides for international arbitration where the investor has brought the suit, the claim in front of a local court, the Argentine court would have been in this case, and for a period of 18 months, the national court has not decided, has not rendered a final decision. In that case, you can go to arbitration. And as David has explained, that really is the core of the issue because BG Group brought the arbitration without going first to the Argentinian court. The arbitral tribunal interpreted this particular requirement, which I will refer to as the local litigation requirement, interpreted this requirement and said it is not a mandatory requirement. It's not a mandatory step to go to litigation first, and also said that in the specific circumstances, which I will get back to in a moment, BG Group was not required to go to the Argentinian courts first. So the question, the real question that was before the Supreme Court in the annulment action was whether or not in interpreting Article 8 in that manner, the tribunal exceeded its powers. And the excess of powers, as you know, is one of the grounds of annulment under Section 10 of the FAA. That's the provision of US law on annulment. So in answering that question, whether or not the tribunal exceeded its powers in interpreting Article 8, the US Supreme Court and the US courts had to answer the even more fundamental question, which was, what is the standard of review? Is the standard of review that you should give deference to the findings of the arbitral tribunal? Or is the standard of review one that is de novo, afresh, without deference to the findings of the arbitral tribunal? That is the core question in BG Group. In the words of the Supreme Court, and that's the quote which is here on the slide, it boils down to the question, who, court or arbitrator, I cite here, bears the primary responsibility for interpreting and applying the local litigation requirement to an underlying controversy? That's what we're going to look at today. But before I'm going to give you the answers given by the Supreme Court to those questions, as I said, I will give you a little bit of background, the sort of previous case law to give you the framework, the legal framework the BG Group decision came under. The first, I'm not going to be able to give you in a minute US case law. You'll excuse me for being very summary, but I will try to give you some basic elements. The first basic element is the one in AT&T, the case from 1986, in which the court basically said that the question whether or not the parties agreed to arbitrate is to be decided by the court, not the arbitral tribunal. Now, I see a couple of puzzled faces. So this is my first time where I'm going to put a little footnote and a little explanation. This does not mean that it is for the courts only. It does not mean that this does away with our good old principle of competence, whereby the arbitral tribunal has the authority to decide on its own jurisdiction. What it means is that at the end of the day, at the moment when the award is reviewed, it is for the court, the national court, to make that final assessment, i.e., that the review is de novo and doesn't give any deference to the arbitral tribunal's findings. That is the essence of that point. It was also expressed in the later very important case of first options from 1995, where, and I cite here, the Supreme Court said, courts should not assume that the parties agree to arbitrate arbitrability unless there is clear and unmistakable evidence that they did so. Again, this is probably a good time to put a little explanation as to the terminology here used, in particular the terminology of arbitrability. We all use arbitrability in a fairly narrow sense, and when I say we, I mean non-US lawyers. Arbitrability in a fairly narrow sense, and that is whether or not a certain subject matter can be brought to arbitration or whether it is for the exclusive jurisdiction of national courts. Arbitrability used here by the US court and generally and also in the BG Group decision means, is there any question or can the specific dispute be brought to arbitration? Is there, for example, jurisdiction? Is there a valid arbitration agreement? Does the dispute fall under the arbitration agreement, etc., etc.? So it's all the questions that an arbitral tribunal needs to decide to find that it has jurisdiction. That is arbitrability from a US point of view. So it's a much wider notion. So these, I think, points are fairly important for the BG Group decision to be understood. There's one more case, and that's the Howsam case of 2002, where the Supreme Court added a little distinction. It continued with the arbitrability question and said, for the arbitrability questions, the question whether or not the parties agreed to arbitrate, that is for the courts to decide. That is a de novo review at the end. However, there are certain procedural gateway questions, and for those procedural gateway questions, those are for the arbitral tribunal to decide, like any other procedural questions. And therefore, at the review stage, we give deference, the courts give deference to the arbitral tribunal's determinations. And the Supreme Court gives a number of examples, and those are extremely important for the BG decision. It says, for example, time limits, notices, estoppel, and other condition precedents to the obligation to arbitrate. So arbitrability on one hand, and procedural preconditions to arbitration on the other. So with all this in mind, the previous case law, let's now look at the BG case, and let's now look at the majority opinion. The majority opinion made a three-step analysis. The first analysis one would call the ordinary contract analysis. They asked themselves, what would the local litigation requirement be if it were in a contract, in a normal, ordinary contract between private parties? And it applied the case law that I've just outlined for you and said, well, that is a procedural requirement, and therefore, we need to give deference, high deference, to the findings of the arbitral tribunal. That's the first step of BG. The second step of BG is to say, hang on a minute, but this is in a treaty. Does that make any difference? Does it make any difference that the local litigation requirement is in a treaty? And the answer given by the Supreme Court is no. It does not make any difference. We come to the same result. And then once they've defined that the review standard is one with high deference to the arbitral findings, they review the award and say, there is no excess of power, therefore, no need to vacate or annul the award. These are the basic three findings of the majority opinion, and I'm now going to go through them in more detail in turn. The ordinary contract analysis is actually a fairly straightforward analysis. You know, they confirmed the previous case law, which was the distinction between arbitrability and procedural requirements, and they applied it to Article 8 in the local litigation requirement in our case. And they looked at the structure and the text, and they found that it operates as a procedural condition precedent. It operates because it determines when the parties can go to arbitration and not whether there is an obligation to arbitrate. And therefore, it is a procedural condition precedent. I find that rather convincing as an argument, because really the parties agreed to arbitrate. There's no doubt that the parties agreed to arbitrate. What was in question is the procedural means, the when and how that obligation to arbitrate can be put in place. And maybe if you want to find some comfort from like a comparative analysis, I can also tell you that other courts have found similarly. I've put here on the slides a decision from the Swiss Federal Tribunal, fairly recent, of 6 June 2007, where also in an annulment proceedings, the Swiss Federal Court confirmed an arbitral award in which the arbitral tribunal had looked at a pre-arbitral mediation requirement, and where the arbitral tribunal, similarly to BG, had said this is not a mandatory requirement. In the specific circumstances, the parties could go to arbitration without prior mediation, and the Swiss courts in reviewing that award said it's not unreasonable for the arbitral tribunal to come to that result. There's also French case law that I don't have time, unfortunately, to get into, where similarly the French courts go maybe not quite the same line, but let me just briefly say, they basically say all these questions of pre-arbitral mediation, litigation, conciliation requirements are question of admissibility and not question of jurisdiction. And by qualifying them as admissibility, those questions are out of the control of jurisdiction at the enforcement or annulment stage. I won't have time to go into this. I know maybe others come back to the notion of admissibility. But I'd be very happy to answer any questions in the discussion that follows. Let's now go back to BG and look at the second step of the majority opinion, where the Supreme Court asked itself whether it makes any difference that the local litigation requirement is contained in a treaty. And it says, no, it doesn't make any difference. Why? Because a treaty is a contract. It is a contract. It's maybe a peculiar contract between nations, but it is a contract. And like any other contract, it is about the interpretation of the party's intent. And therefore, the intent-determining framework that applies to ordinary contracts also applies here. They left open one specific question that was put to the court by the Solicitor General in the amicus brief, and that is, would you have come to the same result if in the bilateral investment treaty the local litigation requirement was labeled a condition to consent to arbitrate? The Supreme Court did not go there. They didn't answer that question. It is a fairly important question because of specific language in the NAFTA treaty and some U.S. bilateral investment treaties. And again, maybe we can come back to that during the discussion. Third step of the majority opinion, once they've decided that the review was one with high deference to the arbitral findings, they go and do that review, and so they look at the findings that the arbitral tribunal made. So as I said before, the tribunal had said the local litigation requirement is not an absolute requirement, and in the particularly circumstances, the emergency laws that Argentina had put in place actually prevented BG to go to the courts, and in these circumstances it would have been absurd and unreasonable, I quote, to require that the investor actually goes to the local courts first. And the majority of the Supreme Court looked at those findings and said, well, the first two are pretty uncontroversial, and the last one, well, we might not have phrased it that way, but we still are happy with it because we give a lot of substantial deference to the arbitral tribunal. So no excess of power, no annulment of the award. Very briefly on the dissenting opinion. The dissenting opinion took issue with the fact that the majority said we don't need a specific analysis for treaty arbitration. To the contrary, the dissenting opinion said the specific nature of treaty arbitration requires a very different analysis. And the rationale is the following. They said Article 8 of the treaty does not contain an arbitration agreement. What it contains is a unilateral offer by the contracting state to go to arbitration if certain requirements are met. One of those requirements is the local litigation requirement. And so the arbitration agreement is only formed once the investor brings the arbitration, meeting the requirements and the terms of that unilateral offer. And therefore, the local litigation requirement is actually a precondition to the formation of the arbitration agreement. And therefore, under US law, that means you should have a de novo review rather than a deferential standard. Now, I do have a couple of thoughts about this dissenting opinion, but I also know that my time is running out, and I also want to hear your thoughts and others. I'm going to hold back on my comments. But I would like to maybe just say two things about the dissenting opinion in conclusion. And these two points are things about the dissenting opinion that I think are quite important to understand. The first, well, there's actually one main thing. And that is that the dissenting judge did not ask the Court of Appeal decision, which annulled the award, to be confirmed. What he suggested is to actually vacate that decision, the Court of Appeal decision, and remand the case at the Court of Appeal level with a specific question. And that specific question was whether Article 8, the unilateral offer to arbitrate, should not include implicitly that the offeree, i.e. the state, also needs to make sure that the investor can go to the local courts. And the dissenting judge also referred to the principles of customary public international law that decided that if there is a exhaustion of local remedies, those the requirement of exhaustion of local remedies does not need to be complied with if doing so would be futile. So you get the impression that the judge, at the end of the day, actually agrees with the majority opinion in the result that the award should not be annulled, but disagrees fundamentally with the reasoning of the majority. Again, something that we can maybe back to in the discussion. My very brief last remark to conclude is both the dissenting opinion as well as the majority referred repeatedly to Gary's Treaty on International Commercial Arbitration, not the second edition, the first edition. So both referred to the treaties in support of their arguments, not on the same points. So I am very curious, and I hope you are too, to hear what Gary has to say about this at the end. So I'm looking forward to the discussion. I'm looking forward to your questions. And I thank you all for your patience. Thanks.
Thank you. So I'll invite Johnny Veeder to give his comments now as well.
Well, good evening. Not having slides, I'm going to do it from the chair and the table, particularly with Gary going to follow me on my right. And let me say, first of all, that this is, in my view, a very important and a very interesting decision. It's interesting not least because, as you've heard, Gary's work, the first edition, was cited twice. First, by the majority in support of their opinion, and then, less enthusiastically, by the dissenting opinion, and I'm putting it politely. But no doubt Gary will come back to that. But much more significantly, because all three opinions will have a great interest to the world of international, commercial, and treaty arbitration outside the United States. First of all, the principal author of the majority opinion, Justice Brouwer, is a very well-known and admired leading jurist on international arbitration. He's spoken over here and in France, and his majority opinion bears the hallmark of his long interest and scholarship in the field, both within and without the laws of the United States. But I do want to say something about the dissenting opinion by Chief Justice Roberts and Justice Kennedy, because that, I think, will be cited for a very long time. It's a highly persuasive document, not least because you've just heard from Maxi, it offered a third way for BG to succeed, which had not been considered by the DC Court of Appeals, nor indeed by the majority of the Supreme Court. Now, my second point is simply this. It's a little awkward for me as a non-US common lawyer, some say very common, to comment on this decision because of the particular terms which US arbitration lawyers have appropriated. So the majority's use of the word arbitrability, which you've heard from Maxi, would tend to mislead not only an English lawyer, but also, I suspect, a continental lawyer, into thinking that it addressed only matters akin to public policy, that is, matters covered by Article 5.2b of the New York Convention. Now, as Maxi has explained, that is not the meaning given to it by American lawyers for at least 20 years, and certainly not the meaning used in this judgment. Now, the distinction also between the majority and the minority is based on a phrase which to an English lawyer begs the question, because for the majority, Article 8.2a of the treaty, which you saw up on the screen, imposes only a procedural condition precedent to arbitration, and thus it's a matter to be decided finally by the arbitration tribunal and not by the court. For the minority, in the dissenting opinion, this same treaty provision is a condition on Argentina's offer to arbitrate with an investor, just as with any other condition in the treaty regarding, for example, the investor's nationality. Now, the trouble is that is not the way the arbitral tribunal expressed the issue as it was then presented by the disputing parties within the arbitration. Now, the tribunal was comprised of three very experienced arbitrators, and significantly here, none with an English language as their first language, nor a US legal training as their first legal training. But in the final award, at page 47, the tribunal identified, forgive me, I've got to turn it up because I want to quote it word for word. The tribunal identified the issue for their decision within the arbitration as one of admissibility and not one of consent to arbitration, nor even jurisdiction, and still less as a procedural condition precedent to arbitration. So if you look at the award at page 47, paragraph 140, the heading is, are BG's claims admissible? The very word that Maxi referred to when she briefly referred to French law, which is the same here in England. And at paragraph 141, and it can't be overlooked if you read the award, the tribunal recorded Argentina's argument that, and I quote, failure by BG to bring its grievance to Argentine courts for 18 months renders its claims in this arbitration inadmissible. Not no jurisdiction, not no consent to jurisdiction. Now, as we know, at least outside the United States, until we read Gary's book again, an objection on the admissibility of a claim is not an objection to the tribunal's jurisdiction, but to that tribunal's exercise of its jurisdiction. In other words, the objection on admissibility necessarily assumes jurisdiction, including consent to jurisdiction, but it objects only to the claim being decided by the tribunal. Now, whereas in England and in other common law countries, to my knowledge, issues of consent and jurisdiction cannot be finally decided by the arbitration tribunal, but only by a court, questions of admissibility are to be decided finally by the tribunal and not by the court. And here, the arbitration tribunal decided in its award on the facts of the case that BG's claims were not made inadmissible, where recourse to the domestic judiciary in Argentina was unilaterally prevented or hindered by the host state. Now, that's almost the same point made in the dissenting opinion at page 17. And again, let me just turn it up. A leading treatise, and this is not Gary's book, I'm sorry. So it's a secondary leading treatise, has indicated that, quote, it is a necessary implication from a unilateral offer that the offeror, in addition, makes a subsidiary offer by which he or she promises to accept a tender of performance. And there's a biblical reference to Lord, but I'm not quite sure what that means. Another must treatise. Be an American thing.
Another treatise.
Another treatise, okay. On this understanding, an offeree's failure to comply with an essential condition of the unilateral offer will not bar an action if failure to comply with the condition is due to the offeror's own fault. Now, if what is being hinted here is admissibility, could it all be a question of language, the difference between English as spoken in the United States and English as spoken in the rest of the world that make up 99% of the English-speaking population, if we include China? Is it ultimately a question of tomato and potato? We can query the dissenting opinion, but we can't ask the same question of the majority, because we can see that it would have made no difference to them at all. And we see that from the partial dissent of Justice Sotomayor. She wrote her partial dissent from a concern that the majority was deciding, albeit obiter, that an express condition on consent to arbitrate was not to be regarded as conclusive in deciding whether the parties intended that condition to be decided by the arbitral tribunal. Now, the obiter dictum appears at page 12 of the majority opinion, where the majority said they did not now see why the presence of the term consent in a treaty warrants abandoning the complexity of our ordinary intent-determining framework. And then they cite two US non-treaty decisions. So what they're suggesting is, even if you draft it as a condition to consent by the host state, that would be overridden by the majority's approach in interpreting a provision in favor of arbitration. Now, this looks like a nakedly pro-arbitration approach decided at the highest level as a matter of policy. And it's possibly provoked by bad facts in a good case for BG and a bad case for Argentina. But as we know, bad facts can make bad law, even with an obiter comment. And Justice Sotomayor warns of the important aspect of consent in treaty-based arbitration. I can read a short passage from her opinion. Consent is especially salient in the context of a bilateral investment treaty, where the treaty is not an already agreed-upon arbitration provision between known parties, but rather a nation-state's standing offer to arbitrate with an amorphous class of private investors. In this setting, a nation-state might reasonably wish to condition its consent to arbitrate with a previously unspecified investor counterparty on the investor's compliance with a requirement that might be deemed purely procedural in the ordinary commercial context. So she attacks the fundamental basis of the majority's approach, that basically treaties are the same as ordinary commercial contracts. Now, there is a problem with the majority's reasoning, not with this result. First, how does a state now draft safely a BIT to express a condition precedent to its offer to arbitrate as a matter of consent and not purely as a procedural matter or a matter of admissibility for the final decision of an arbitration tribunal? What guidance does the majority opinion give to state draftsmen? And I would suggest not much. If there is an answer, it lies in Justice Sotomayor's opinion. And the second, I think, is much more serious. We see here a very pro-arbitration decision by the US Supreme Court, the first time it's addressed treaty arbitration. And ordinarily, we should be very grateful, very thankful, and applaud the Supreme Court. But it forms a pattern, both in this country and in certain other countries, of very pro-arbitration decisions. We've seen in very recent times the growing turmoil with the Tapi case in France. Now, France has traditionally offered for over a century the warmest hospitality to arbitration, until now. In the last few days, we've seen the public uproar against the introduction of arbitration by General Mills, the US's largest food company for its customers and other co-contractors. Now, that was abandoned by General Mills within days in what the New York Times described as a stunning about-face. It was simply unacceptable to the public at large to have arbitration forced upon it. Now, it would be a paradox if our courts continued to swing heavily towards arbitration just as public opinion turned against it. It's an historical irony that in the past, popular revolutions abolished state courts in favor of arbitration. This was popular justice. This happened, we know, in 1790 with the French Revolution. It also happened in Russia with the provisional government when it issued a draft arbitration code in July 1917, never enacted at the time for obvious reasons. But the Soviet government promulgated its own arbitration code in 1918. Now, if we move to today, both in the United States, in France, in England, it does not seem likely that arbitration would be a similar popular cause. Just ask yourself tonight, what would Mr. Farage and UKIP say on their posters if the BG decision by the US Supreme Court had been made not against Argentina, but against the treaty's other contracting state, the United Kingdom? And sadly, the mind does not boggle here. And so it may be that in years to come, it's the dissenting opinion, drafted principally by Chief Justice Roberts, that will be quoted and more likely quoted by laymen rather than lawyers. But we have reached, I think, a very historical decision in the approach by a senior court, a common law court, to treaty arbitration. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Johnny. Gary, would you like to offer an intervention, a reflection on these two presentations?
I'd love to offer some reflections, both on the presentations and also the decision in BG Group. I'd like first, of course, though, to thank you, David, and Maxi and Johnny for stimulating and interesting introductions and overviews of the case. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming here today. I hope it's time well spent. A few preliminary thoughts about the decision, because sometimes there are points that can get missed. You know, of course, the first question that anybody involved in international arbitration asks about anything is what law applies, choice of law question. And sometimes that gets put to one side or overlooked. In this case, what law should apply? We have a bilateral investment treaty between Argentina and this country, the United Kingdom, and the U.S. Supreme Court happily, in an annulment action, went off applying cases like ATT Communications and Housam versus Dean Witter, cases firmly rooted in the domestic as in domestic United States, Federal Arbitration Act, to that bilateral investment treaty award. That's not the most obvious place, one would think, to address questions of whether there was a valid arbitration agreement in that bit, in that Argentine-UK bit, or alternatively, depending on how one characterizes the point, whether the local litigation requirement was intended to be one of jurisdiction or admissibility. Presumably, one ought to look to the terms of the bilateral investment treaty for the applicable legal standards, either as to whether the standing offer from Argentina had been accepted, forming a valid arbitration agreement, or to how one ought to characterize and what legal consequences one should give to failure to comply with the local litigation requirement. But neither the majority, nor the dissent, nor the commentators addressed that question. And the proper answer to that has to be that the law isn't the law of Washington, D.C., which isn't selected in the bit and which was chosen fortuitously in that particular case. That can't be the place, a seat of arbitration selected after the standing offer to arbitrate had been accepted, validly or invalidly, and having nothing to do with Argentina and the United Kingdom negotiating that treaty between themselves. Certainly, in this particular case, how one characterizes and what legal consequences one gives to the local litigation requirement must be matters governed by public international law. And one would have expected, therefore, to see citations in the majority and the dissent to the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties, for example, and not so many references, for example, to AT&T Technologies and Housam. Now, it may be the case, not that bad cases make bad law, but instead that easy cases make hard law, to play with the various analogies. This was a very easy case, I would suggest. This was a case, no matter which way you turn the prism, where BG Group's award should have been upheld. It should have been upheld either because you applied a deferential standard of review. That's the majority's conclusion, as you've heard, and I would suggest the right conclusion. Or alternatively, no matter what standard of review you apply, it ought to have been upheld because the arbitral tribunal got it right. If a state says you can't litigate meaningfully in our local courts, no sane legal system allows that state to turn around and say, well, you didn't satisfy that requirement, so you can't arbitrate against us. That doesn't make any sense either. So even if Justice Roberts was wrong in his initial conclusion about the relevant standard of review, he was right, he was correct about his suggestion that you'd get to the same result anyway. Aside from the question of applicable law, though, should we be looking at international law to arrive at either of these two conclusions, relatively easy conclusions, or US law? Aside from that, and I would suggest you would get to the same place if you looked at international law as the majority did, aside from that question, it's interesting to think a little bit, and this sort of addresses comments made by both Maxi and Johnny, a little bit at this question of terminology, because so much in both the majority opinion, the dissenting opinion, and the remarks we've heard turn on the words you use. On the one hand, you can characterize the local litigation requirement as a condition to consent, or alternatively, an element of acceptance required for valid formation of a contract. When you characterize the local litigation requirement that way, it produces certain legal consequences. It means that as an element of consent, as an element of jurisdiction, there will be de novo judicial review. And there may be other legal consequences as well. Alternatively, as the majority did in the BG Group case, the majority of the Supreme Court, you can characterize the local litigation requirement as one of procedure, which then, in turn, has its own legal consequences, namely a highly deferential standard of judicial review of the arbitral decision. Alternatively, again, you can characterize it as a question of admissibility and arrive at essentially the same result as the French courts and as Johnny suggested, might be sensible. I would like to suggest, though, that we're all too grown up to let everything turn on terminology and legal vocabulary. And that what we really do most of the time is a practical question of looking at not the labels, but instead the underlying interests and objectives that are at play when we attach those labels, when we attach those conclusions to particular issues. What's really at play here when we talk about the characterization of the local litigation requirement? What's really at play, I'd like to suggest, is the following. What's really at play is two contracting states here, just like commercial parties in contracts, trying to design an expert, efficient, neutral, and enforceable dispute resolution mechanism. That's why parties include pre-arbitration, negotiation, and cooling off periods. The idea is that parties may be able to resolve their disputes between themselves if they discuss it. That's why parties include mediation requirements. Parties may be able to settle their disputes without spending lots of money. And that's why, equally, at least in large part, Argentina and the UK included a local litigation requirement in their bilateral investment treaty, a chance to give Argentina or, as Johnny suggests in the future, the United Kingdom, a chance to solve things at home before elevating them to an international plane. Well, when you think about those objectives, trying to accomplish an expert, efficient, neutral, enforceable dispute resolution mechanism, how are they best served? Are they best served by letting national courts, in whatever place happens under the bit, to be the arbitral seat, apply, as often as not, local law to the question of what review they should give to the arbitral tribunal's award on this question, and then how they're going to resolve that underlying question, putting aside what standard of review, as to whether or not the local litigation requirement was satisfied? I would suggest that on all the main objectives of a local litigation requirement, of any pre-arbitration procedural requirement, on all those main objectives, justice is served, those interests are best served by treating the local litigation requirement as something, whatever name you give it, something entitled to a high degree of judicial deference. And that's because, and this was hinted at, actually said in both Justice Sotomayor's concurrence and in the majority opinion, that's because an international arbitral tribunal is more expert at interpreting the terms of a bilateral investment treaty. Among other things, it won't apply the wrong law the way all three sets of courts in the United States did. It'll apply the right law. It'll apply the BIT, which is what the parties negotiated. It's also more expert because it has had familiarity within the entire arbitral procedure, and it, unlike a national court in some randomly selected place like Washington, will know the details about litigation requirements in Argentina because the parties have put it to it in the 250 pages of submission that led to the 250-page award. They're also more independent and neutral and predictable because they are tribunals selected by the parties or an international institution rather than some randomly selected arbitral seat like, again, Washington, D.C., that has nothing to do with the dispute. It's more predictable because it's the arbitral tribunal instead of a randomly selected arbitral seat. And it's more efficient and enforceable because, and I'd go back to David's very lengthy timeline, including the 3 or 4 years of appellate proceedings after the award, you don't need to have that added layer of judicial review effectively, neutrally, and expertly to get to what was actually a pretty easy result in this particular case. Final observation, international arbitration makes strange bedfellows. Chief Justice Roberts, appointed by one of the more conservative United States presidents in recent history, cited extensively from Brigitte Stern's various dissenting opinions in several of her awards. It is interesting how easy cases not only make, in this instance, hard law, but also strange bedfellows. And with that, David, I think we've taken more than enough time from our audience.
Thank you, Gary.
The majority of the two strange benefits that are
true. That's true, yes.
So I'd like to open the floor to questions here in the room or online. Please, so there'll be a mic that'll be brought to you, and if you could state your name. One second, a mic will be brought to you. Two-part.
Then state your name.
Two-part process. It's a condition precedent. You get the mic.
Thank you so much for a very interesting presentation. And my question will be more related to Maxi's presentation. I found it really interesting, the discussion about to treat the treaty interpretation and contract interpretation the same way. I actually find some, when we speak about treaties, right, we are in the realm of public international law, and we know that in public international law, the applicable law here would be Vienna Convention and Law on Treaties, which contains very specific principles on how to interpret international treaty. And it gives priority to ordinary meaning of the words, which is literal interpretation, rather than looking to the intent of the parties. So that's why I find the contractual interpretation here a little bit, maybe disputed. And secondly, when we speak about the intent of the parties, as Maxi has mentioned, the main purpose of the interpretation is to establish the intent of the parties. While in the case of ordinary contract, it's much easier to establish the subjective intent of the parties, which is like in the case of ordinary civil contract, let's say, we have parties which are represented by physical persons, like it could be private person or could be CEO of the company or lawyer. In the case of state, it's really very difficult to establish the subjective intent of the party because state is a very complex structure, right? And the negotiation procedures of the ordinary contract and treaty are also quite different from each other. So I would like to hear the opinion of any member of the tribunal, if it's really comparable, if we can really compare the treaty interpretation and contractual interpretation, because we have like lots of principles in many like different civil codes of different countries. They are like really a lot, while in public international law we have very precise principles, and we cannot really. The main question here, I think, is the applicable law, which is the applicable law here. Yeah. Thank you.
Maxi, would you like to take this question?
I'd be happy to. And also, I'm sure others will comment as well. Thanks a lot for your question. It actually gives me the opportunity to say something that I forgot to say when I was doing my presentation. And that is, as much as I think that the Supreme Court decision on the majority is fairly convincing on the ordinary contract analysis, when it comes to the second step and the treaty analysis, the least one can say is that the rationale and the reasoning is fairly thin. And just as Gary said, and just as you pointed out, I think it would have been very welcome to have at least an attempt to apply the principles of international public international law and the principles in particular of the Vienna Convention. However, if I were to defend that part of the Supreme Court decision, I'm not saying that's my opinion, but if I were to defend that part, there is a lot of debate, academic debate at least, between the public-private divide and how much public and private divide isn't really important anymore today, and how these two systems really should converge. So here's a Supreme Court who applies principles of private law, ordinary contract interpretation, to a fairly public international law setting. So at least one can maybe think that thinking outside the box should be something that one should applaud, or at least think that it has a lot of courage to it. Mm.
Could I just add a phrase? So I wish I could defend the language of the United States generally, but on this point, so it's a very unusual case that it's not a treaty to which the U.S. is a party. So the question is the application of international law in a municipal legal system, in this case the United States. There is no statute about interpreting treaties. So the question is one of how custom informs common law in the United States. A number of circuit courts, court of appeals, would apply the Vienna Convention to treaties. The Supreme Court has avoided talking about the Vienna Convention and the law of treaties. They take the transformative school. If you go back to Denning in the Trentex case, they take the transformative school, which is we've looked at custom back in 1820, long before on interpreting treaties, and then we close the window. Now we have a rule in common law, and they talk about that rule. But they don't even cite to that here. I would say they don't apply private law. They actually make an analogy to private law, which you said in your presentation. But they are thin on the second part. Johnny, you want that?
You made the point I was going to make. The U.S. is not a party to the Vienna Convention. And it may be difficult for the Supreme Court politically to refer to such a treaty. But if you look at the dissenting opinion, it's clear that those two justices had very much in mind the Vienna Convention. The materials they cite to the Vienna Convention. And the professors, Amici Curia brief, Professor George Berman and John Townsend and others, puts the Vienna Treaty in the forefront of their argument. So I think you can defend the dissenting opinion, very much more difficult with the majority, and you can't do it at all with the DC Court of Appeals, which treated it simply as a simple commercial contract. So it is a bit surprising.
It's interesting because the Solicitor General, the principal U.S. legal officer responsible for arguing cases in the appellate courts, urged the court to apply the Vienna Convention, cited the convention in his brief to the U.S. Supreme Court, on the basis that although the United States is not a party to the convention, it expresses customary international law, and as has been said, courts of appeals have often cited to the convention. The majority, without hardly any explanation, appears to conclude that it should be applying domestic U.S. law to the questions before it. And I think Roberts, although one can charitably deduce a reference to international law, leaves it pretty oblique as well.
So I would only add one theory is why the Court of Appeals are willing to use it and not the Supreme Court. Hmm. If you applied the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties and the U.S. was a party, then you should not give particular weight to the views of the United States as to the interpretation of the treaty. Whereas the common law rule that's now adopted by the Supreme Court implicitly says give more weight to the negotiating position, which is not in the treaty. So it may be that as last resort, they think that's important. Mm-hmm. That's giving them a lot of forethought, but that seems to be, to me, part of what's going on. Yes.
Alex Layton, I'm a practicing barrister. The last few moments have been discussing the second stage of the analysis about whether or not treaties are different from the ordinary contract analysis. I'm picking up something that Gary said, which seems to me to relate to the first stage of the analysis, which is if you're doing an ordinary contract analysis, why are you not starting with a question of what system of law applies? Why are you not applying some conflict of law rules to determine whether it's an English contract, an Argentine contract, which system of law is most likely to occur, apply, and so forth? Is there any nod in any of the decisions at any level to the conflict of law analysis when you're dealing with it as a private law matter?
The only nod is in the majority, which cites, and it's hardly more than a nod. They cite the New York Convention Article 5.1e by analogy, saying that you should that the law applicable in an annulment proceeding is the law of the seat, the annulment forum, and that's the only, so far as I can tell, that's the only, and it's a sentence with two citations after it.
And why don't you take you as far as the conflict rules?
Yeah, exactly. It sort of sets up a question, doesn't answer the question. But I think one can deduce from that they believe that U.S. law therefore applies. The therefore is left unexplained.
Well, I wonder, Gary, could you comment, I think following on Alex's question, that another tendency in the U.S. is because there's 50 states, so it's not applicable in this case, but there is the conflict of law, the choice of law discussion is not extensive in federal courts generally.
True.
And there is a tendency to, with so much, particularly in any sort of complex litigation, where you have several states involved, to somehow conclude the rule, the analysis will not make a difference in this case, and therefore we're going with something else. But I wouldn't say it's the most robust subject studied in the U.S. So it's compared to 30 years ago.
I mean, to be fair, if you sort of think about it, imagine this wasn't a treaty and this was instead a contract between, let us say, Argentine and English parties. That contract, that arbitration clause, had selected Washington, D.C. is the arbitral seat. It's not an implausible scenario. Were that the case, it could very likely be that U.S. law, some version thereof, that's a whole separate domestic conflicts of laws issue, but U.S. law, as the law of the arbitral seat, would impliedly govern, or by default govern, the arbitration agreement, and hence provide the right answer to, or at least the applicable answer, to all the questions we've been talking about. That's why I raised at the outset the fact that this is actually a treaty, and therefore that ordinary presumption probably doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
You mind if I follow up the question with a question for our Americans? Because Gary talked about strange bedfellows, but the strangest bedfellows are those who make up the majority. I mean, just read them out. You've got Breyer over here. You've got Scalia over there. I'm sorry, Gary. I know that's
I belong
that's defamatory.
Here. It's not defamatory.
You've got Thomas, Ginsburg, Alito, Kagan, all joining in. Now, as we know from The Brethren and other more recent books, these majority opinions are negotiated word by word, comma for comma. And I'm just wondering whether an express reference to a treaty to which the US was not a party, an express reference to customary rules of international law codified in the Vienna Convention, a reference to conflict which might lead you to English law, Argentinian law, God knows where, was simply too much for the majority to stomach. David.
The wording, using the analogy of private law seems so odd that I'm wondering if it was a compromise. They moved off of the second part of the opinion. Yeah. We have an analogy, we're safe there. I mean, they're not that it's so logical to start with an interpretation of the treaty. And then they could have said during that analysis, this is consistent with what we do with private agreements, which would have really matched your public-private convergence question in some ways. It's possible. It could be that it's not that important to some of them. Would be a different option.
Maybe just to follow up on Alex's question on the applicable law in a private setting, without taking into account there was a bilateral investment treaty. As Gary pointed out, the real question here was one of qualification. You know, even though you disagreed on whether we should all care about this labeling, but it was really whether this is a procedural requirement or whether this is a question of admissibility or jurisdiction, et cetera, et cetera. And that qualification, being a private international lawyer, is always done according to the law of the lex fori. So at least that was a question for the U.S. court to decide according to U.S. law, and then to decide on what the applicable law would be. But the initial question of qualification is normal that it is done according to U.S. principles.
Yes, Morris.
Here at Beaux-Tard.
Oh,
I'm
sorry.
Actually Griffith rather.
Excuse me, I apologize.
Can I put a reality into this? I happen to invite Nina Scalia and his wife to supper at the Cosmos Club the Wednesday before this case. And I said, Nina, there's a very exciting case on next Tuesday. I said, the international arbitration mafia, or some of them here, are very excited and interested about it. Oh, he said, I wouldn't know about that. What's its cause? What's it about? And I said, oh, I'll send you a note from Gar about it, and perhaps you know, you could become interested in it. So I sent it off to him next morning. His secretary, Angela, wrote back and said, oh, thank you very much for your note I've given to the judge. He's now going to get involved. But we lose track of the fact, although we got so excited about it, and Albert Yarn was sitting in there in one of the judges' seats listening to it. But for them, it's just another case. For someone such as Nina, just another case means another United States case. It doesn't mean an international law case. About 20 years ago, I went to a conference, NYU invitation only, and Scalia said he thought it was unconstitutional to have references to international law before the United States Supreme Court. So it's not really surprising that when we read the judgments, we have, and I must say I was somewhat shocked, basically an expression of opinion that a treaty is just another contract. But that's how you look at it when you're up on the hill in Washington. There's a different perspective. And I think we have to be realistic when we think what excites us is not something which excites the court so much, even though there was a little bit more commotion and activity on the court on that day than there is in just another case. But they got it right. And I think we can hope, as Gary says, that they'll maintain getting it right, even if we don't think the expression of their reasons reflects our very informed view as to how outside the United States this system of international dispute resolution actually works.
Now we'll go to Morris. Thank you very much.
First of all, just an observation, which is that in England, and I suspect other common law countries, if the court doesn't want to observe a procedural requirement, for example, in administrative law, they say it's merely directive, it's not mandatory. Secondly, and this is really a half-baked thought, and some might think all of my thoughts are only half-baked at best, but I'm wondering whether the distinction, the idea of procedural requirements, isn't too unsophisticated. That's to say, if you take it for granted that as a matter of contract law in the United States, procedural requirements are subject to the judgment, essentially, of the arbitrators and that deference will be given, there are procedural requirements and there are procedural requirements. If you have an LCIA terms of reference, then there may be things in it which are to do with the procedure of the LCIA and its tribunal, which are very appropriate for the tribunal to decide. But there might be other questions which maybe shouldn't be labelled procedural at all, but more to do with consent. But even if you call them procedural, are different kind of procedural requirement where there is no particular reason to give deference to the tribunal at all. Once you've got, given the premise that a court normally has to decide on whether the tribunal's got jurisdiction, because otherwise how do you distinguish between abuses of jurisdiction and just stepping a bit outside? So given that premise, what I'm trying to suggest, or thinking aloud, is that there are procedures which are not merely procedural and which are appropriate, therefore, for the tribunal to have a major say in. There are procedures where it might be more appropriate for a more rigorous examination by a court. Thank you.
Please, Johnny.
It comes down to a question of trust. And the trust issue is now very real in the negotiations between the European Union and its two possible partners in the new free trade agreements with the United States and with Canada. There is a tremendous resistance growing against any investor-state provision being put in those two treaties, because it's not just the NGOs, it's others who simply don't trust the system. One possible compromise which has been offered is a requirement that the claimant, this would be an American or Canadian claimant, as an investor, would have to exhaust a local remedy in the particular state which has affected its investment. So it is possible, unlikely, but possible, that these treaties will include a local litigation requirement. And it won't be 18 months because we have to cater for Italy, so it'll be a little bit longer and not measured in months. But let's say 3 years. When that is put on the table, people will quote Gary and say, oh, but we've got to have a remedy where there's a wrong and the arbitrators are the best people and international arbitration works better than litigation, which we all know it does. We're the specialists in the field and we are confident that we're right. But it is a question of trust, and I think there isn't a trust that the words of the treaty will be respected by claimants and by arbitration tribunals. And the trouble with the majority opinion is that it confirms that mistrust. Is that however you draft it, these bad guys are going to find a way around it and make it a decision for an arbitration tribunal to which the state, in this case the European Union, has not consented. And that is, I think, the problem, is that we talk to each other, we persuade each other, I agree with Gary, but actually out there, the majority don't. And the more they find out what we do and what we say and how we say it, the more appalled they are. And I'm now very concerned that these two treaties will not have investor-state arbitration provisions at all. Australia did it, and it may be the Commission will do it again.
We've sort of been edging up to this. But firstly, of course, the majority of people out there don't distrust investor-state arbitration. That's why there are 2,800 investor-state treaties, right? If a majority of people distrusted it, there wouldn't be any of those treaties. A few states have, Ecuador, Venezuela, abandoned their commitments under bilateral investment treaties, but the overwhelming majority of all states has concluded that it's in the best interests of their people, and the governments that have entered into those treaties have been elected and re-elected and re-elected again by whatever local mechanisms may exist. Commercial parties continue to use essentially the same mechanism to resolve their commercial disputes. Arbitration may get suggested in some untenable situations, like General Mills, or domestic political machinations. Typically, when that happens, those proposals get withdrawn promptly. Or, if the arbitral process gets misused, it gets found out a lot more reliably, to be honest, than local court proceedings in many jurisdictions in the world, which is, of course, the whole reason that we've got international commercial and international investment arbitration and why it works so well. It's not really a question of trust only. I mean, parties do trust international arbitration. That's why they use it. It's also a question, and it goes back to what I said previously, of efficiency, neutrality, expertise, and enforceability. And on all those counts, international arbitration does better than the alternatives. Why do you think BG Group didn't go to Argentine courts? It's a question of trust. It's also a question of expertise and neutrality. Why do you think Argentina, which could have done, didn't go to Argentine courts and instead went to arbitration, albeit reluctantly? The reality is, and I think all of us in this room who have a common interest, the reality is arbitration can sometimes, in some contexts like investment arbitration, consumer arbitration, make for a good poster girl or poster boy of bad things. It's our job to stand up for the institution that actually does a really good job in delivering justice when otherwise it's not available, whether to BG Group or one of us. Hopefully, today's session, like the majority decision here, can carry on that pro-arbitration track record, not just today, but into the future.
I hate to add anything right after that, but can I say that I think Gary, I would suggest both Gary and Johnny are right. Actually, you're not opposed. I would just do a slight twist on what Johnny's saying, that I think in terms of Gary's proposition, if we took the rule of law index, which ranks national courts, arbitration would do very well on that ranking. If we added the fact that the claim is against the state, it would do even better. If we added the fact that it's a claim by a foreigner against the state, it would do outstandingly well. The distrust, I would suggest, Johnny, is of globalization. Mm-hmm. And the arbitration system is, as Gary said, the poster child that you can really focus that distrust on. It's not necessarily the right target. If you remember when in Seattle, 1998, there were protests against the WTO ministerial meeting. And the question became, why are you protesting the WTO? Mm. But it's not really the WTO. It's you need something to focus on if you're opposed to globalization. And arbitration has been one thing to focus on. But it's not, I would agree with Gary, it's not the logical target itself, per se. Gary, what time are we going to? We have time for more questions?
Maxi's in charge.
We're going till 8 o'clock. We have more questions. Jan, did you have a question? Is that a hand up? Yes. Oh, and there's one in the back, I'm sorry. So we'll go first in the back, please. You could state your name and then.
Yes, my name is Jeffrey Hartwell. I'm one of those laymen that Johnny was talking about earlier. And I wanted to ask a mischievous question, which is this. Would we all be sitting here discussing this if the arbitration tribunal had adjourned for 18 months?
That's the one for you, Max.
I'll take that one.
Well, I can maybe just take one question really to the facts that we didn't go into detail about, but that is underlying all of the discussion and that justifies the fact that both the majority and the dissent and any other way you look at it, you might think that the right result is not to annul the award and the right result would be not to suspend the arbitration proceeding for 18 months, is that there was a law enacted in Argentina that clearly said that under certain conditions and for certain claims, you should not go to the national courts. You could not go to the national courts. So, I mean, this is really fact-heavy related, but for the same reasons that the arbitral tribunal found that under the circumstances it would have been unnecessary to wait these 18 months and enforce the investor to go to the courts, I think for the same reason, it would probably been unreasonable for the arbitral tribunal to suspend the arbitration for a year and a half.
I mean, it's not just a mischievous question, it's a really good question, and it sort of highlights a couple points. One point is there's actually a fairly developed body of arbitral authority that says, albeit mostly in the context of pre-arbitration negotiations and mediation requirements, says, yeah, it's a mandatory requirement, but you can satisfy it after the request for arbitration is filed. Therefore, and there are a number of recent investor state awards that actually adopt this reasoning. Say, you filed your request for arbitration 12 months into the 18 months. At the time you filed, the requirement wasn't satisfied. The requirement can be satisfied, though, by the time that runs after the filing of the award. And you see decisions like that both in the commercial context and in the investor state context. You also see decisions, and this goes back to something Maurice said a little glibly, but correctly. You see a number of decisions that look at negotiation and mediation requirements and conclude that they're not mandatory. They're aspirational. Or alternatively, conclude that the breach of those requirements shouldn't result in denial of jurisdiction, but because at the end of the day, an agreement to negotiate or an agreement to mediate isn't necessarily, in fact, isn't likely to bring you anything. And therefore, that, although there might be other remedies for breach of that kind of agreement, denial of jurisdiction isn't an appropriate one.
So, one question up here, sorry. And I think this will be our last question.
Yep. My name is Christer Sörlund, Stockholm, Sweden. If we take a few steps back and look at a point of departure, it is that point of departure is that a state can make promises. It can make promises to other states or to any, let's say, amorphous mass of investors of some kind. But that doesn't automatically mean that there is a means of enforcement. That does not mean that the state has an obligation to submit to international arbitration or any other kind of dispute resolution. So what we have here is that the state actually did make an offer. You can make unconditional offers and you can make conditional offers. This offer was combined with certain conditions, which we think, and rightly so, were stupid. But I think I've read somewhere 40, 50 years ago that in order for a contract to form, a offer has to be accepted according to its content. So if you accept something else, you do not form a contract. In this case, you don't form an arbitration agreement. I think the situation is very simple, and if you think a thing is simple, usually you miss something fundamental. I'm aware of that. But I think, Gary says that, it's uncontroversial. Arbitration should be efficient and effective and expeditious and whatnot. Sure, but I don't think you can, by these general considerations, look away from the contract formation process. And if a party has made an offer to arbitrate, which it wasn't under an obligation to do in the first place, you have to abide with it. So just to give a little spice to this debate.
Well, just to say that you're actually in very good company, because the dissenting opinion actually went exactly down that line and had that analysis that if there is a unilateral offer under certain terms, the acceptance must match those terms. Otherwise, there is no agreement to arbitrate. And therefore, they argued this would need a de novo review. Well, you could argue, on the other hand, fine, you have certain conditions. The question still is what types of conditions are those? And the arbitral tribunal said that these conditions exist, but they are not mandatory. And therefore, in certain circumstances, you could step away from those conditions. And the arbitral tribunal therefore found that still there was an arbitration agreement that had been found. Just in the same way that the exhaustion of local remedies under principles of international law that were also referred to by the dissent allows you in certain circumstances not to go down that route and still meet that requirement. So I think you're absolutely right, and you're in very good company because the dissenting opinion had exactly the same analysis.
I would like to thank everyone here and online for coming tonight. Part of tonight has been a discussion about an important case, but part of it has also been a celebration of a book. And to me, it was quite appropriate that Gary called on us to be guardians of something that we know so much about, because he has certainly expressed his sense of guardianship in these three volumes. And we're very appreciative of the effort you've put into those, and we offer our congratulations. May you join me in thanking him and in thanking the panel. Are we meeting somewhere? So please come up and discuss with the panel. Thank you for coming.